In the fall of 1946, Kay White and Donna Niles, veterans of the World War II Women's Army Corps, left New York City on a vacation to New England. Due to a sick puppy they had with them, they spent a couple of days in a friend's cabin halfway up Mount Kearsarge to let the puppy recuperate. They were so impressed with the area that a short time later they purchased 26 wooded acres at the foot of Mount Kearsarge. The parcel was on the west side of Old Winslow Road in Wilmot. It is here they decided to put down their roots and try homesteading the land, which they called Freedom Acres Farm. Wild fruits and berries were plentiful, and in 1949 Kay unearthed her grandmother's preserve recipes and made several different types of jams and jellies. The result was so successful that she and Donna decided to send them as Christmas gifts to their army buddies and friends in New York City. This generated a great demand for more of these delicious preserves, which ultimately turned into a 40-year mail-order business they called Taste of the Wild. In this interview, Wilmot Flat resident Loretta Reno, who was a close associate of Donna and Kay for 28 years, shares firsthand stories of Donna and Kay and their jelly business that ultimately brought 45,000 tourists a year to Wilmot.
They were right here in Wilmot Flat. Kay White and Donna
Niles. They built their place and they did it all on their own. They had, I want to say, help in the sense that, you know, when they were digging the well, like the people up on the mountain, the old guys up on the mountain would come down, or they had their horses, or they told them, if you did it this way, it would be easier. And they read books about how to do different things. They made friends. I think that after a while, when people thought, how are those women are going to do that, that when they saw that they were determined and they were trying and they were doing the best they could, that everybody pitched in and said, oh, this is an easier way to do that. Do it this way. Because they were city girls. They didn't really know all of that stuff. And I think people came because of that as well. They were already established. They were building their little houses and putting them together and all of that. And what I heard at the time that my mom and them started working for them, it was because that's when they started making jelly. That was before I came along. And so they named it Freedom Acres.
Do you know any reasons why they named it?
Some people, when it said Freedom Acres, they thought it was a nudist colony. And there were actually people who would call or come up with the idea that they thought it was a nudist colony. So all kinds of things, when you say freedom, that it brought all sorts of stuff out. But I understood it was not because of the service. It was freedom to do stuff that they wanted to do, that they could do it the way they wanted to do it.
Obviously, you had contact with them in the service. You had an emergency trip home because of your stepdad being ill.
And Donna Niles was the one who was stationed, graduated from the first officer's course class, and she contacted her friend, and they put me on the plane and sent me home. When I got married and I settled down and bought the house, I got a job working for Donna and Kay, and I would work for them on weekends. And they had this old Model A Ford, so I would take the rubbish to the dump. I would do odds and ends of things for them. They would reminisce with me, and I would get some of the stories of how they started. And that's when I started meeting a lot of their friends that were from New York, from all over the place. I worked doing everything, selling. I ended up doing the secretarial work. I did all of that. I did the ordering for the different gifts and things. They were very, very good people to work for. I can't say enough about them. They were good for the town. They weren't selfish. They thought about everybody. They loved the customers, their dogs. My stepdad would go up there when we would go on bivouac and stuff for, you had to, you know, once a year you had to go to Camp Drum, and he would go out, make sure that the cows were milked, and my mother would stay up there. I have two aunts, they're deceased now, but my aunts were really friendly with them, and they would go and stay overnight up there. They would come up from Massachusetts or Manchester and stay there, and Donna and Kay would be gone for a couple days, or else they would go out to Wisconsin to see her mother. They employed all the people around town. We used to have a lot of good times. One New Year's, they were gone, and they knew we were going to have a New Year's party. We did. They called in the middle of the party to see how we were doing, and we had a big New Year's party up there. It's a wonder that everybody made it down the hill. They were just good people. One of the things I remember Kay telling me is that she used to go to Danbury, and she would help do the plays there in Danbury, I guess to raise money maybe for the Grange or stuff like that. And she was very friendly with the Phelpses and different ones that would come up there. That's me. This is Kay and Donna, and this is Marilyn Bacon. But okay. She was married to Dick Bacon, okay. And she worked there for a long time. And her mother used to live where Beth Palmer has her, that's where the mother lived, where Beth Palmer has her business. I helped make the jelly. I did all the capping, and we did them all by hand. Still had to put the cover on the jar. It came down from the ceiling, and you could smack at one, and it would tighten it up and stuff like that. Donna and I were the only two that could really get that sense. So we did all of the tightening. We had to pack them away, and then we had to, when it came into the winter, that was when we would put labels on them. Did everything by hand, and the labels, then we had to lug them back out there again. Everything was done by hand. If there was just, say, maybe 10 boxes or something going out, we'd drive them down and bring them down to the post office. Otherwise, when it was really busy, especially at Christmas time, the postmaster would come up to Freedom Acres, and he and, well, my husband and myself, so we would pack them in the big containers, and we'd leave them there. And then in the morning, I think they came out of either Concord or Manchester, a post office truck would come and pick them up. They'd be all wrapped and ready to go. Each one was tagged for what state they were going to. So it was a big thing. I mean, there are thousands and thousands of jars. And the gifts that, you know, you could buy little gifts, and the gifts were like they tried to fancy up a little jar of jelly, and they built all the little containers to put the jelly jars in. And then when Kay got her flowers going, and a lot of the garden clubs would come up, then she would go to different places and talk about the flowers. Your garden people, you know that they would come once a year. If they made the trip, you know they'd want to come back. When some of the big buses, they used to back up the hill to get up there because it was too hard. They'd go up around, but it was hard getting down the dirt road. And so a lot of the buses would back up. There'd be four or five buses all parked up there. They were in the Reader's Digest twice. I think it just spread that way, because when I came around, you know, people were coming in, And they did have a lot of friends, and they knew a lot of important people, I want to say. The one that sang "The Moon Comes Over the Mountain," Kate Smith, and then J. Edgar Hoover.
He came?
Yeah, they got letters from him, but she was here in New London because, and that's when they come over the mountain. It was Kearsarge Mountain she was singing about, "When the Moon Comes Over the Mountain." That was that mountain. So, you know, right, just word gets out. They didn't even need Facebook or anything then, you know. It was just by word of mouth. Kay was fine with her flowers and her, you know, all this stuff, and she would like being out there. But Donna was, she was a whack, and she was, you know, she was in charge of women, health issues and everything like that. And she was, she was a diplomatic person, but I think that she wanted to be part of, really be part of the town. And that's when she ran for selectman. And, of course, they were only men selectmen at that time. And there was a big thing that if she ran, that they would not work with her. And they didn't. I don't think at that time she thought she would even win, but she did. And, of course, in town, it was a big thing. And it was kind of a sad thing because I know that, I don't know if they're in here, but it was about how what happened was that these men just resigned and made fools of themselves is what it was. They made fools of themselves. And that women could... that women could be selectmen, and
political beings.
In one of the, you know, and of course, being a little town like that, it was hard. I mean, she had quite a time there. And there was thousands of letters that they got because she did, she won. And so what happened is when she won, she could, with the state, they had to go to the state, and she was allowed to choose one other person. And then together they could choose a third person. You know, you didn't have to vote them in because those other guys had quit. So for the state, so she, Dick Bacon, his wife Marilyn, she worked up at Freedom Acres. She's the one that you saw the picture there too. And so Dick had his own business, and so she asked Dick to work with her. Would he be a selectman? And he said he would. So then together they had to go ahead and pick somebody else. And I couldn't remember his name, but I see that it's in here. And so the third person that they picked was Phil McLaughlin. And Phil McLaughlin lived right across from library, well, just up a little bit from the library, right across the street. And Phil was a really neat guy. I can't remember the state that he was from or where he was from, but the three of them did a good job, and the three of them worked as select people for quite a few years. But all the letters, and I kid you not, I don't know how many
so
I've got there.
So show us what you've got down there at your feet. You have a pile of letters still in their envelopes.
Right, and those are all, these have all been opened, gone through. There's a whole bunch of newspaper articles. I didn't want to keep them all, but I went through them all, and I kept the ones that I thought maybe were the funniest, or the ones who to marry Donna. they were, you know, good health, they loved working outdoors, they would make a good husband, and there was a lot of laughs there. I think maybe most of those might be in here. From all over the world, good for you, keep it up, keep up the good work, all of that stuff from all over. And, you know, this was, I mean, it was a special thing. And she stayed on for a long time. She was a good selectman. When the old community center, the first community center there, was the Grange. The Grange had to sell, and I was living right next door to the Grange. I can't remember how I became aware of, not the fact that they were selling the Grange, but the fact that the man that wanted to buy it was going to sell used furniture, and it was going to, I'm not sure, I can't remember what else he was going to do with the business. But I was thinking, I said to myself, geez, you know, here we are with the kids and the dog and the cat, and, you know, that's not going to work out, is it? And I mentioned that when I went to work. And the next day when I went back to work, Kay said to me, she said, we'd like you to buy the building. We'd like you to buy the Grange. And I said, you know, I can't buy the Grange. I don't have any money. And she said, no. She said, we're going to buy the Grange, but you're not going to tell anybody. We're going to give you the money. And I think it was $1,000.
So you worked for them through 86. They were still in production, and you were
right
with them for...
Right, and it was right after 86 that that last year that Kay had her operation, and she died then. Yeah.
And you lost Stanley then, too.
Yeah.
And then you took care of Donna during her declining years.
When I went up, Donna was... I didn't realize it, but Donna apparently had a stroke, and they had been to the doctor and everything, but I didn't know about it. That was when Kay was alive. So she had that stroke before Kay had died. And then I went up to, I was working that new job that I had, and after working at Freedom Acres all those years, and I was working at the insurance agency in London, and I was going to school in Plymouth on insurance stuff. And so I was, you know, I hadn't been up to see her for a while. And so I went up, and when I went through the office part, I went in the back way and went through the office part, and I noticed in the office where I worked that she was having difficulty writing her check. And it was for her insurance, health insurance and stuff. And so when we got in there talking, and I said something to her about it, and she said that she knew that something was wrong with her, that she was having trouble, and that maybe she should go see the doctor. And so that's when we went to see the doctor. And really, from that time on, she really went downhill.